Good morning, students. Today I'm here to present theme 2 of the book, The Themes of Indian History, Part 1, Class 12. Theme 2 is Kings, Farmers and Towns. And with this we have Early States and Economy during the period of 600 BCE to 600 CE. As we know, the chapter is having king's name. That means it is actually dealing with the political setup as well as the administration. What are the sources for this chapter? There are several developments in different parts of the subcontinent during this long span of 1500 years. So there are various sources available like Rig Veda, inscriptions, texts, coins and visual materials. Rig Veda was the first Veda written by the Aryans in the Vedic age, and inscriptions are the engraved symbols or scripts on the stones or rocks. Text means the books available with us, and coins that was issued by various kings. Visual material consider we just like statues, pillars, temples, buildings. James Prinsep was the first person. He was the British official of East India Company who deciphered. Deciphered means who read this script written during this period, that is Brahmi and Kharosthi. These two scripts were there, and these scripts are used in the inscriptions and on coins also. These are the pictures of inscriptions and coins. You can see Brahmi script on the pillar also and on the rock. We have different metallic coins over there, silver and gold. And you can see these Kharosthi or Brahmi scripts on these coins, and even the figure of kings over the coins. In this chapter, we are come to know about 16 Mahajanpadas. But what is Janpadas? First, we should know that is Janpadas meaning the land where a Janpada, a people, clan or a tribe sets its foot or settles down. And if these people acquired large area and they establish a kingdom, then we called it Mahajanpadas. In this book, 16 Mahajanpadas names are given. Among them are Vaishali, Avanti, Ujjaini and Magadha. These Mahajanpadas were ruled by the kings, and some of them were Ganas and Sanghas. Mind it, they are not Mahajanpadas, they are Ganas and Sanghas, and they were always ruled by oligarchy system. What is oligarchy? This is a form of government where power is exercised by a group of people or men. There is no king. So there were Ganas also, there were Sanghas also. Among this 16 Mahajanpadas, we are having this, you can see here. Among these 16 Mahajanpadas, in this book we are studying, or in this chapter we are studying about Magadha only, because that was the most powerful Mahajanpada of this period. Why Magadha was so powerful? Because it was having a region where agriculture was especially productive, and there were iron mines, and that provide resources for tools and weapons. And other element was there of elephants. They were a very important component of army, and they were found in the forest in the Magadha. Magadha is the present Bihar, Jharkhand and some regions of West Bengal. Other element of this Mahajanpada, that was the powerful rulers like Bimbisara, Ajatshatru and Mahapadmananda. The last dynasty who was ruling Nanda before modern dynasty, there was Nanda dynasty ruling the Magadha from 329 BC to 321, and the last ruler of Nanda dynasty was Dhanananda. He was overthrown by the king Chandragupta Maurya, and he founded the Mauryan dynasty with the help of Chanakya in 321 BCE. BCE means before common era. During Mauryan empire, Magadha became a most powerful Mahajanpadas, Magadha culminated in the emergence of Mauryan Empire. That is, culminated means it reached its highest development during this period. What are the sources for Mauryan Empire? That is also very important. We have different types of sources available. Like we have Chanakya or Kautilyas, it is the name of one person, Chanakya and Kautilyas. Arthashastra, this is the name of book. Arthashastra was written by Kautilya. In this book, we have the various information regarding the Mauryan Empire's administration. And we have the Maxenius Indica book. Maxenius is a Greek scholar or ambassador to the court of Chandragupta Maurya, and Indica was his book. He wrote many things about Chandragupta Maurya's court, and he was having the close relationship with the Chandragupta Maurya. Next we have Buddhist, Jain and Puranic literature, and as well as in Sanskrit literary works we are having sources of this particular period. Above all, there are inscriptions of Ashokas on rocks and pillars. They are very valuable sources which are providing maximum information of Ashoka reign. The famous kings of Mauryan Empire was Chandragupta Maurya and Ashoka. Ashoka was the king who annexed Kalinga. Earlier, nobody able to annex this Kalinga. Ashoka was so powerful and he was a big warrior. So, he annexed Kalinga, and after defeating Kalinga, he expanded the boundaries of Mauryan Empire to the eastern coastal region of Odisha. In Ashoka's inscriptions, we don't find the name of Ashoka. There are two other names like Piya Dasi or Devanam Piya, which is written for Ashoka. These names were actually decipherable by James Prinsep through the inscription, and he says that Piya Dasi or Devanam Piya, the words are used for Ashoka. This is the extent of Mauryan Empire. You can see from Afghanistan towards down the south, we have various all Janpadas and Mahajanpadas under the control of Mauryan emperors. These are the symbols, or these are the buildings we have found in very sound position. That is Ashok Stamba, and you know this, four lines are there. We have taken this as our national emblem, and this is Ashok Stupa. Like this stupa you can see in Deri Kutub Minar, that is Lostam over there. It is like same thing, but that is of iron. And this shows the glorification of the Mauryan Empire during the Ashoka period. Now, next is very important aspect of this chapter, that is the Mauryan Empire. It is very important point we have to discuss. This is Mauryan Empire, and we'll discuss it now. Mauryan administration we will be taking up now. There are five major political centers of Mauryan Empire besides the capital. Capital was Pataliputra. Earlier the Magadha's capital was Rajgriha, but it was shifted to Pataliputra in 400 BCE. Other provincial centers for Mauryan Empire was Takshila, Ujjaini, Tosali and Swarnagiri in Karnataka. These provinces were controlled by the army of Mauryan Empire, because Mauryan emperors always want to ensure the security of their boundaries. So there was big army to control all these provincial states. I've shown you this. We have on the map, this is Takshila, this is Ujjain, this is Swarnagiri, and this is Toshali and Kalinga, which are the provincial center of Mauryan Empire. You can see in this flowchart also, this is central government, that is at Magadha. Kings were ruling from there, from their capital, that is Pataliputra. In north, provincial center was Takshila. In the west, there was Ujjain. In the south or Dakshinapa, there was Swarnagiri, and in the east there was Tushali and or Kalinga, we can say. Maxenix indicates in his book Indica, there are committee which consists of 6 subcommittees which look after the entire military administration of Mauryan Empire. First committee was looking after navy. Navy is an important part for Mauryan Empire because the coastal line was so big, they want to protect their kingdom from the coastal side also. So navy was an important part. So they were having the first subcommittee of navy. The second subcommittee was dealing with transport and provisions, which they provide bullock carts to carry equipment, procuring food for soldiers and fodders for animals, and recruiting servants and artisans to look after the soldier. That means this particular committee was responsible for the supplies to soldiers. And the third was responsible for foot soldiers, and the fourth for horses, the fifth subcommittee for chariots, and the sixth committee for the elephants. These are the very important subcommittees, and they often ask in the examination. Ashoka's contribution towards the administration, that is, he tried to hold his empire together by propagating Dhamma. He was expanding this Dhamma aspect in his empire. This would ensure the well-being of people in this world. He appointed some officials, specially known as Dhamma Mahamatra, who spread the message of Dhamma. According to Ashoka, Dhamma includes respect towards elders, generosity towards Brahmanas and those who were renounced worldly life, treating slaves and servants kindly, and respect for religions and traditions other than one's own.